We're here at the Toronto Honda Indy and 2009, and presenting this year a fantastic support event presented by Time Warp Racing, Vintage GT Challenge, which brings out cars from the G70 class, which was created by John Brett and others. John currently heads up the series and organizes it. John, how did this series start out?
Well, G70 itself started out as a set of rules, which is then integrated into the Vintage Automobile Racing Association set of rules and became its own class. And it's been steadily growing for the last 3 years. And now it's one of the predominant vintage classes in North America, cars from the early 70s to 1989. In Canada, we don't have as many classes as they do in the U.S., so it's a combined class. And we run a lot of high-profile cars from various series like SCCA Trans Am, the IMSA series, CASC, and SCCA GT series. And they're all on track together, running in various groups. And that's it's really done well. We're happy with it. So, and we're also happy to bring it to this event. We did it once in 2006, and it was a success. The crowds loved it. They said, oh, I used to drive one of those. I remember those cars. And so we're back here again at the invitation of the Toronto Andretti Green people.
Okay, yeah, AGR, of course, putting on the event this year. And, yeah, that's absolutely rings true. There isn't a person in the crowd that wouldn't identify with some car out here, or some driver in some cases. In fact, we do have a special guest who we'll be talking to a little bit later. Tell us a little bit about Walt McKay and what he brings to this event.
Well, Walt McKay, nobody really knows his exact age, but he's got to be in the early 70s. And he's been racing for 50 years at Mosport, ever since it started in 1962.
That's right.
And he actually was a pro driver for the Comstock team, driving a King Cobra. So he has a wealth of experience and knowledge in the racing community, but he's the most reserved, understated guy you'd ever want to meet. But just a charm on the track, gives you tons of room to go and buy, but he'll race you hard if he has to. And, you know, he's a true icon and our hero.
Okay, that's fantastic. Yeah, we read up on Mr. McKay a little bit last night, and there is a great deal of glorious history that he'll hopefully share with us later. Right now, we just have the benefit of being inside while there's a torrential downpour outside, and but that's going to make for an interesting bit of event on the track today. We're going to be going out for qualifying at 11 o'clock on probably a wet track. What's that going to do to your grid?
Well, just before this interview, we got word that the track has actually been closed due to the thunderstorm and lightning activity, so they pulled in the track workers and delayed things, which is quite good for us, because we need to, you know, let this get out of the system, move on, so we can get out for qualifying. This is a very difficult track in the dry, so it's compounded times 10 in the wet. It's concrete-lined walls, there's very little runoff areas, there's only three actually out of 11 turns. So it's a little dicey, and you know, we're putting 40 vintage cars out there with various degrees of speed and power and handling. So it's, you know, a lot of drivers are nervous, myself included.
I was just going to ask, how are you adapting to it? I know that over the years they've refined the circuit somewhat and taken the wall in and left some curbing, so that, you know, if you do click an apex, you're not necessarily taking a corner in your car with it.
Yeah, unfortunately, we had a couple of incidents in practice yesterday where one of the cars actually clipped it too close, got pushed to the other side of the track, hit the tire barrier, rolled his car. The driver is fortunately fine. He's a very stout roll cage in that car. But yeah, these are the risks. And, you know, we've invited drivers that we think are capable of dealing with this type of track, but now we're adding another element of weather into it, and it's not just a light shower.
Absolutely, yeah. It's going to be an exciting day. So, John, why don't you tell us real quick a little bit about your car here, the number 89 car, the Firebird.
The 89 car. This is a, let's just move pan over this way. This is an ex-Motorola Cup car. It's always been a race car. It was driven by Roger Bailey, Dave King, John Coombe, myself, and was prepared by Strudwick Motorsports. It's just an endurance type car. It's won some 6-hour races and did a lot of 3-hour Firestone, Firehawk, and Motorola Cup races. It's pretty much stock. It's a car with power windows. It still has a heater in it and a radio.
It's a thrill for me to see it, because I've seen many of these cars race at the Indy through the years, of course, in the Players GM Challenge and other groups too. So, yeah, fantastic. So, great show, John, and good luck with releasing this weekend.
Yeah, we're happy to put it on for the crowd, and you know, we know they really enjoy it, and we had a good field out yesterday, and everybody, you know, was coming by and saying what a great show it was, and the marshals are excited to see our cars here, and hopefully we'll be back in the future.
Fantastic. It is an invitation, pretty much. You do have something in the neighborhood of 40 cars entered this weekend, right?
That's correct. It is an invitational, and we've got some guys who don't normally crew with or drive with us from the States. We have one guy from Newfoundland, and also our furthest driver came from Monaco, and he's driving a Shelby Cobra, and I think we'll probably meet up with him later on.
We'll definitely make that a big stop on the tour. So we'll carry on around the paddock, and thanks again, John, and good luck this weekend.
Thanks, Rick.
Harley, who came all the way from Monaco to race in this year's Toronto Honda Indy. What made you come all this way?
Oh, I raced back in Europe and later on in the FIA GT Championship with modern race cars, mainly Porsches. And my last race I was Sebring the 12 hours in 2002. And then there was this gap until now. And we're friends with Peter Kluth from Legendary Motor Car here in Toronto. And we had this idea to build a unique car, which is this original 1965 Shelby Cobra in the SXY livery. And I own the original car of that. It's just a restoration project. We spent several months to look at all the parts. So that was the most successful Shelby Roadster ever. And we're rebuilding it. And this is the one, the duplicate of that one.
So this would have been the original sponsorship that it ran with?
Yeah, exactly. Identical car, it's identical, just a little bit stronger engine, I think, and, you know, a little bit of better setup than in the early days.
So is this the 289 or the 427 variety?
Well, that's the 427, the big 7-liter, the 7-liter engine.
And the original vintage car would have been what year?
1965. And this was the winningest Cobra of all times. And we just try to revive the project, and we're happy to be here. It's a wonderful event. If the weather clears out.
If the weather clears up, but it's going to be a thunder boomer, and we're pretty sure it'll clear up. But I was fascinating as I watched the events unfold this morning in qualifying that you were you came right to the top of the charts in a mighty hurry. So it showed that you had some experience. Have you driven on a closed circuit before, on a street circuit with concrete around?
I did race the Porsche in the Porsche Super Cup. That's like the support race of the Formula One, similar to here, in Porsche Carreras in Monaco, which is the same type of track like here. So we have the same thing. Lots of concrete, some fences, and no mistakes, please.
No mistakes, please, and keep it brave and keep it on the line. Are you dealing with the traffic okay? There's some slower cars out there.
Traffic was very intense, especially here, because it's kind of tricky to pass by, and some people don't look in the mirror, so it's kind of tricky to do a time. And I pulled until 3 minutes before the end, and then John went in there and he snatched it off me. But he's local, so he deserves it, so that's good. So I'm happy to be here.
Okay, well, I'm sure you have another chance to show him up later on in the weekend. Well, pleasure meeting you, Andre.
Yeah, and thank you very much.
It's a real thrill to have you here.
Thank you.
Awesome. We are basically cool down and work your way over there.
And the fabulous Diane Dale. Diane, great to see you here. And Diane is one of the co-founders of the G70 group in Varac and a longtime competitor. Well, not that long because you're not that old. I know that for a fact. But so Diane, you've been with this outfit for pretty much since it started, right?
Yeah, pretty much. We've been racing with the G70 since about 2003. We started up. John Brett was the first car out there by himself on the grid.
Yes, bravely so.
And then we sent out a ton of emails, and we visited a lot of people, and we talked to everybody and convinced them all to come out, and the group's been building ever since. So it's really fantastic to see this many cars out. We've got over 40 cars on the grid this weekend, and that's amazing to see.
Yeah, that's definitely a way to fill out a field, too. Like, really open it up to the competitors and let everybody have fun with it. And it's great for the crowd, too, because they just can identify with virtually any car that's out there, including your fantastic little 240, which you've bravely driven for many years. And I must congratulate you, too. You got up to about sixth place there in qualifying this morning. So is the car pretty much... what's the history of this car? When was it actually built?
This car actually is a 1971 Datsun 240, and it's been racing since 1972. It was down in the States. It's an SCCA e-production car, and they raced it down there. But all the logbooks dating back to 72, so it's great to bring it back. We brought it up to Canada about 9-10 years ago. did some new cage work on it and kept the engine up to speed. We've got a 280 engine in there now.
Oh, very good, yeah.
And kept it pretty much as clean as we could.
Well, anyways, Diane, congratulations on starting where you start. And do you think we're going to get some dry weather today?
I don't know. It's a tough call right now because it stopped raining. We don't know if the track's going to be clear in the next 20 minutes or not. So it's a tough call right now.
How are you in the wet?
Not that great, to be honest. But we'll try. We've got some good rain tires, and we'll try to find a dry line on the track. That'll be new for us.
So. Yeah, you got rain tires. That'll definitely help you. And I guess you just got to stay for a rain line, which is as yet unproven.
It is for all of us, though, so it puts us all on the same boat.
Okay. Well, keep her clean there, Diane. It was wonderful talking to you again. And Diane Dale and her fantastic 113 240Z.
Thanks, guys.
And a special guest we have here this weekend, actually a special invited guest, it's Walter McKay, a longtime Canadian sports racing legend to some and new to me since I'm a little bit younger, but nonetheless, welcome to this event. Are you excited to be here?
Oh yeah, very much so. Yeah, I think it's great. Yeah, except I'm not too happy about the rain because I've got 12-inch slicks on this car, so I won't be running in the rain, but we did get out in qualifying this morning and it was great. And probably get out tomorrow morning.
Fantastic, Walter. I was reading up a little bit about your stellar history and some of your exploits in the past with the Comstock team, and that's a topic for a much longer discussion, I would think. But some fantastic racing history you saw there. How does this feel like racing today and after all you've been through in the past? But do you still race regularly?
Maybe 4 or 5 times a year.
Yeah.
Mostly at most sports now. But in the during the 90s, I was lucky to drive cars for a real enthusiast called Murray Weibel in Brantford. He had a Brabham BT16, I drove. He had a Alva BMW sports racer, and also a Lotus Formula B car. So they were great cars to drive.
Yeah. Well, would that Lotus been among one of your favorites that you drove in your career? Or?
I would say so. Although I've driven quite a number of cars. But yeah, that was one of the better handling players, I would say.
Yeah. That's fantastic. And just get a shot there, Jeff. The man's actually got wrenches in his hand. This shows you, like,
I always have wrenches. Always carry wrenches.
Always carry wrenches in his hand, is honest. That's what experience teaches you, right? To always have wrenches at the handy.
You have to keep checking yourself all the time.
Yeah. Do you have any other cars that you play with from time to time that are race-worthy?
No. Not at the moment. I'm a co-owner of this car. But I do have a 64 Porsche that I drive on the street. And, I still work preparing older Porsches, 356 and really not about this.
Okay, so it's a passion and it's a hobby and it's some income too, right?
And that's some income that helps too.
Yeah, no doubt. Especially when you get put gas into this baby. 1987 Mustang. What's the build history on this?
Okay, well, we bought this car originally. Buddy and I bought it 5 years ago, and we've done a lot of work on the handling since. And originally it was a drag car, and now it has a 347 freight motor from Ford. We also changed the transmission to a 5-speed Tremont transmission, and we spent a lot of time on the handling, for the different power steering pump on it, changed the lower control arms, pump steer kit, and so on.
Did you find that starting with a drag car was an acceptable way to go about it? Or was it half built?
It was half built, but we have put a lot of time and money into it since then.
And I also noticed that you've taken the crate out of the engine too, because you know, like, that wood would just slow you down and probably cause a fire too, right?
It probably would, yeah.
Well, Walt, absolute pleasure to meet you, and hope to speak with you a lot more and go over some of the glory days.
Okay, thanks for coming over.
All right. Thanks. Walt McKay. We'll here with Al Ferguson, another competitor today running in the Varac G70 Plus class here at the Indy. It's a number 24. It looks like a British product. Tell us about your Hot Wheel there.
Yeah, it's a British product, all right. It's a 1962 Jaguar E-Type. We ran it stock for a couple of years, and then we started to develop it a little bit. It originally had a 3.8-liter straight twin overhead cam 6 in it. We've upgraded that engine to a 4.2-liter. Makes about 320 horsepower.
Not like the V12. Not like the big guys, the Vets and the Cobras, but it's enough for us. More than enough for us.
No, absolutely. That's a fantastic little engine, and well, actually, probably not really a little engine, but you got some beautiful headers coming out of that thing too. Well, what's the history of the build on this car?
We found it actually in a junkyard in,
is that right?
In 1990, and we started building it in 91, and our first race was in 93, and we've been campaigning it everywhere from Sebring to Mosport, Kelly City.
You know, this car was a little bit lost for a place to race in just because of the way the rules shaped up in Varac, and then, well, tell us about how G70 saved this car's racing career.
Yeah, well, we had to go, we were a little bit over-prepared for Varac rules, so when we started racing in the States, and that became too expensive, we really didn't have a place to go racing. And then Varac and Swissam came up with G70, and that created a place for me and a whole bunch of guys like me to go racing, and I think it's just great.
There's a tear to my eye. Okay, thanks for those extra words.
Okay.
So have you been racing yourself? What's your racing background?
Well, I crewed as a kid, and then when I finally earned enough money to be able to participate, I was pretty old. So that's why I'm a vintage.
Yeah.
But we had a lot of fun.
Yeah, so there is something, there's always a hope at the end of the rainbow, right? That someday that you'll have just scratched just enough coins together to get out and basically
and
work.
Do what you wanted to do.
Do what you want to do, which oftentimes is like working at a car at 11 o'clock at night when you really rather just be having a drink and relaxing.
A lot of that when you have a vintage car, yeah.
Absolutely. Okay, well, nice talking to you, Al, and I think we're going to take another view at the car, or maybe not, but we're carrying on. Okay, I'm here with Richard Piper, yet another competitor here in the G70 ranks at Toronto Honda Indy this year. Fantastic vintage challenge. It's a big thrill. Were you here in 2006?
I crewed here in 2006. I didn't have a chance to run. I was just starting my vintage career here, and I helped some buddies, so I had an opportunity this year to get in, and I'm here. It's great.
Fantastic, Richard. So where are you from exactly?
Actually in Sunderland, just north of Mosport there. So, yeah, convenient for me to be down there. So.
Yeah, I know the area, and it's also close to Mosport as well, too. So so tell us about your ride. Is this yours? Or?
Yeah, this is mine. And actually, I sort of got the bug watching these guys doing this and decided this is something I wasn't going to pass up and say later in life that I didn't take the opportunity. So number 41 is actually meant for the year I built the car. I was 41 years old, and I put this thing together.
You built it yourself?
Yeah, I did it. I found this in a street car sitting in a garage up in Minden.
Oh,
and drove it out and decided we were going to put this thing together. So 4 years later, we finally got it working properly, and we're having an absolute blast over here.
Awesome. So it's a 944,
yeah,
what spec?
944 turbo. And this sort of was an original street car. And we built it up from here, and every year you do a little more. And keep breaking stuff and keep putting it back together.
Yeah, you do break stuff. Did it start out as a low miler?
No, it was actually had fairly high miles on this thing. We got it. I knew the guy was the original owner, and he drove it for what the car was meant to be driven for. And from there, I just sort of morphed a little more into the racing and went off the road.
Did you run it with the old motor just to get started?
Still got the stock motor.
No kidding.
We rebuilt it because it's a little tired. Yeah. It's still got the original 2.5 motor in it. Ready to go.
So what's the horsepower then? About 230 horse, or what's the spec?
Probably in or around 240, but we've put a slightly larger turbo on it. We're still going to stock motor. There's a couple things done to it. It takes it up a little higher.
That's fantastic, Richard. I noticed I saw some clips on YouTube, I believe it was. You and Ian Locke were having a fantastic fight.
A couple of Saturdays ago, we got going in the rain together there, and Ian's a great competitor. He's the rain master. He's got all his experience from ice racing. So when he gets going in that Volvo, man, he's a hell of a guy to race. It's a lot of fun.
It makes you mad, though.
Oh, no, not mad at all. Just watching him go, he's a challenge. And he pushes me, and I push him, and we had a great time. So we finished 1-2 in that race in the rain, and it worked really well. So,
are you finding a similar kind of thing? Do you have anybody sort of sneaking by or catching you up on the slow corners at all?
There's a lot of good drivers out here. And this is my first time around the track, so I'm still doing a lot of learning. Yesterday didn't give us a lot of seat time. This morning was a great, great run. But there's a lot of guys out here, so don't take anything for granted.
Yeah, and I imagine you have to do, to be safe or feel safe, you have to do a fair bit of mirror driving. Is that the case?
Oh, yeah, you always watch out for who's coming around you, because you want to focus on what's ahead, but I think a smart driver also knows what's coming behind them, so just be careful.
Yeah, what white Cobra or white Corvette that's really built really well by LMC.
Oh, yeah, there's guys still coming by me at 15 seconds quicker a lap, so you know they're coming sooner or later. So.
All right, good luck, Richard.
Right,
I know we're going to get back out there eventually, so, and congratulations to your little cleanup crew here. That's fantastic. Yeah. Look at the shine. I understand. Lance, how's it going out there?
You know, I'm having a blast, actually. This is, actually, I'm a rookie right now, so I'm in my rookie season, and this is my first time at the Indy, obviously, as well, and transitioning from rally into road racing is a whole new game, you know, and it's a lot of fun. I love trying to figure out the tracks. I love the kind of engineering side of it, trying to figure out each lap how you can take another tenth off, and, oh, wrong gear on that corner, let's change that next. It's a much different game than one shot only in the rally courses, but super fun nonetheless.
Yeah, rally, you're really just sort of hold on for this corner and hope I made the right guess, whereas in road racing, you're constantly refining the car lap after lap.
Yeah, and the other challenge is that's different from rallying is in rally, you're kind of by yourself. You start on 30-second intervals, and here you're door-to-door. And I'll tell you, door-to-door changes everything. You know, when you start... you calculate your lines, and then next thing you know, there's a car there in your line, you know, so you got to kind of remap the whole thing. So you're constantly changing your lines out there and adjusting for cars that are ahead of you, beside you, and behind you. So there's a lot going on. It's fun.
How does it feel to be among one of the youngest drivers in this group? What's it like racing against all these seniors?
You know,
I'm just saying that to be mean.
It's an incredible group of people here, you know, and last night we had a problem, we were blowing tools off people, and everyone's quite willing to lend a hand, and I think everyone's goal at events like this, it's much the same as Targa Newfoundland when we were there, you know, it's much the same as, you know, everyone's goal is to get everyone to the finish, and I think that's what's cool about the vintage guys, you know, they're a lot of fun to race with, everyone's cool, no one's, you know, everyone's going to work on Monday, and it's, they're good people.
Yeah, absolutely fantastic. So you got a couple people crewing for you this weekend. It looks like you got a full complement of help as you're being kicked back and forth by a torque wrench on the other side of the car. Yeah. So there's one thing I got to take a shot of there, though. Jeff, hopefully you get a shot of that tachometer Lance has in the car there. That's always a real treat for me. Just to tell... still got the dollar sign there, yeah. So basically, you get up into over 6,000 RPM, it's dollar sign time. Thanks a lot. Nice talking to you, Lance. Indy, who is either Scottish or Italian.
Italian.
Italian. Dino is the third part of Time Warp Racing, which administrates this outfit, G70 in a sense, and helps to field a lot of cars and search out cars and buy and sell cars and
store them, bring them up to safety standards, and then put them on the track so people can see.
Right on, Dino. So this is one of the latest additions?
This is a 72 Corvette, but it has an 82 nose on it, or an 82 tail on it, and maybe an 82 or 1980 nose on it, which is what they used to do back then. You know, as soon as the aerodynamics came up with these things, they would switch them over.
Oh, fantastic. Okay, so is there any kind of a racing provenance to this car or history?
There is a bit of a history. It's been around the London area, and it's done some road racing, and then it did some drag racing, and it used to be driven by a guy named David Brackstone, and it used to run around London with the Labasse Special Light logo on the side. So, but then, like I said, it's been off the track and onto the drag strip, and then back on the road track. So we brought it back to the road.
Okay, so this is again one of the co-owned cars, pretty much in your group.
Yeah, the company owns all the cars, and what we do is one of the guys picks the car for the year, maintains it, looks after it. You know, get it ready to put on the track, and then we put her up for sale.
That sounds like a fantastic way to go. I don't know if that's too far off of what Kevin Buckler does with his racers group down there in California. I think you guys are off to a good start. It seems like a good business model. Have you seen other precedents of this? Because I think in Canada, it's the first time I've ever seen that.
Yeah, we haven't seen it in Canada. Most guys, they'll prep cars for guys and keep them for it. Like Legendary does that. But they're the really high-end guys. What we try to do is keep it to the entry level.
Yeah.
You know, and that way, guys who want to get into it, they just don't have to spend a lot of money. Mm-hmm. And they get a car that's already prepped for them.
Right. And so you guys get along great with a handshake and cooperation?
We have contract.
Oh, we do have contract, yeah. When you're talking about tens of thousands of dollars.
Yeah.
Absolutely. So what's your racing history like?
I started in 2003. And with a Bug Eye Sprite.
Okay.
And I still have the Bug Eye Sprite. And we hooked up one day and we said, if we're going to do this as a business, you know, we got to formalize it. So we all went away with the idea of putting down on paper, what do you want to get out of it? You know, to see if we're going to be compatible in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
We all came back with essentially the same notes.
Yo, fantastic.
So we said, okay, we're all on the same page, form a corporation, get it going and start it.
Oh, that's absolutely fantastic. I didn't know it worked out that way, but indeed it worked out quite well. So how are you doing out there on the track? Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Mind you, I have a little 305 in this car. We haven't found the right motor. So the 305 is out of a Camaro, and we know absolutely nothing about it. It could be stock, which would be 145 horsepower.
Mm-hmm.
It could be a little bit up from stock, like they used to put in the Z28s.
Mm-hmm.
So that may be up to 190.
Yeah, absolutely, and probably wise choice if you haven't run here before, to run with a little less power and feel brave doing it.
Well, I ran this car, the red car, in 2006.
Okay.
And it was a lot of fun.
Alistair is driving that one today, I believe. What kind of output does that one have?
We don't know. We haven't put them on the dyno, but that's got a Cosworth, I think it's a 2.3 head on it.
Okay.
So it's quick, and it's got really, really good brakes. Handles superbly. This one, I had slicks on it yesterday and this morning, and I just put the rain tires on with the slicks.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I have more ground contact with one of those slicks than I do on all four wheels of my Sprite.
Yeah, I was just gonna say.
When you're going down and you have two pieces of pavement,
yeah,
and one's just a little bit lower, or the tire hits the seam, it goes.
Yeah.
It just follows it. So
yeah.
It's a whole different feeling.
A whole different feeling, and plus the horsepower too. Well, both cars are similarly balanced, but night and day when it comes to power to weight.
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay.
They're a lot of fun on the straightaway.
Oh, these guys.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. The Bug Guy, you could probably, like, have a sandwich while you're waiting to get through.
That's right. You go up the back straight at Mosport, and they're trying to go, like, let's see.
What am I doing for dinner?
Yeah. You're on your BlackBerry.
Yeah. I often thought a lot of drivers should keep a stereo in their car at times like that.
Actually, that one used to.
Really?
Yeah, we had a radio in that one, but we never played it.
Well, awesome talking to you, Dino. Looking forward to what other kind of great machines you guys, you, John, and Alistair, and I guess Diane's input some extent. Yeah, fine.
We're working on a 1979 Jag XJS V12. Mm-hmm. And then another winter project next year is we're going to try and get a RX-7 out.
But there you go. Another nice little roundabout and a chat with
the third of the triumvirate.
This is my team over here.
Oh, yeah. Just a shout out to the team.
Hey, team.
Hey, turn around.
Who's racing a fantastic little Porsche. Carrera, what year is this car?
74
Carrera. I just love the sound of that, let alone look of it. I have a real soft spot for Porsches, and particularly this vintage. Are you running a 2.7 engine?
It's cheated up to a 3.2 by now. Yeah.
Okay, well, you want to do a double take on that and cut out the cheater? Or no, that's the great thing about G70. Yeah. You can ring pretty much.
So, yeah, we can do whatever we want.
Yeah. So, where are you from exactly?
I'm from Toronto.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And have you run, what's your racing history?
I'm an instructor with the Porsche Club.
Oh, very nice.
And I've been racing with Varac for 8 or 9 years now.
Yeah? Yeah. Okay.
It's good.
And, can you give us a preview as to what we might expect this August in the big Porsche Rennen that's happening at Mosport? Or?
I think there'll be a ton of cars there.
Yeah.
Hopefully not too much mayhem. Big clean racing, and that's what we always aim for, so that's what we're going.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Do you have a mechanic that does all your work for you as well?
Over there on the right is Jarko Matkuski.
Okay.
He's completely built this car for me.
Is that right?
And it's kind of cool this weekend is that he's got his two sons with him as a pit crew.
Oh, that's really wonderful. What kind of horsepower do you think you're getting out of your Carrera right now?
Well, I don't want to let the cat out of the bag too much.
Yeah.
I'd say somewhere in the 300 to 320 range.
Yeah. It actually looks beautiful with that classic Carrera side marking. You said the car was built not too long ago? Or?
The motor is fresh from this winter. Yeah.
The chassis itself, did it come as a...
It was managing the speed car when I bought it 10 years ago.
Oh, I see.
It's slowly but surely converting it.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Oh, hang on. I'm getting mic mixed up syndrome.
Any case. All right. Well, good luck out there. And,
thank you very much.
And hopefully you're going to get some dry track. And I'm going to be a fan of yours all day. In fact, you know, you might find me cleaning your car. I'm such a fan of Porsches.
All the help you can get. Thank you very much.
Okay. Bye-bye. Racer of the Volvo 122, is it?
Correct, yes.
What year is this car?
It's a 1968.
Then why does it say 168 on the side of the car?
Just my number.
That's your number?
Yes.
Okay. Now, this car used to be an ice racer?
No.
You used to be an ice racer?
Yes.
You still are an ice racer?
Yes.
Okay. So anyways, we just went through the whole paddock talking to all the G70 competitors, and you're a classic example of how this class really worked for you when you were shut out of other classes. Can you explain how that worked for you?
I was before running in Vintage Historic, but now I'm running in the G70 class, and it's actually fun running with the big, powerful cars and working our way through. Enjoying.
Yeah. Are you finding with you're kind of down on horsepower to like probably most of these guys at 120 horsepower?
About 150.
150? Okay. All right. So it's a cheater ball then.
Correct.
Okay. Good. So are you having to do a lot of mirror driving, or how do you actually work that out when you're out there, and especially in a circuit like this that's a little bit foreign to you? That's your first time here, of course, racing. How much of the time are you mirroring, or can you do that just in your peripheral vision?
It's usually you can go maybe 6 or 7 laps, and then the leaders will start coming apart, and hopefully you catch them in a good spot where you can have some room for them to get by you.
So are you using the common wave by
yes.
Politeness, turn left, go that way?
Gentleman racing.
Gentleman racing. And so what's the drama you've been having with this little buggy today?
We're just going to put the rain tires on, and we had a problem with the wheel stud. So we couldn't actually get the wheels back off again. So we finally have rectified the problem. So we're in good shape now.
Rectified, damn near killedified.
Oh, yeah. Well, that's fantastic. You have anything? You got some fancy sponsorship this weekend too, sporting new Team E shirts. What's that all about?
That was actually a friend of mine's son. We're going, well, we don't have a team name, and he goes, well, why don't you just call it E? Everybody calls you E.
E. Like,
my name's only three letters, but they got to shorten it anyway. So.
Shortened it into a letter that doesn't even exist right. In your name, in fact.
Yes. So some of my sponsors, like Bradley Advertising, or my main sponsor, she provided us with all our clothing. And second time around tire is located in Toronto. Also, University Works and Danko Signs did all our graphics for us. And also, All Glass and Mirror from Ajax.
Yeah, it doesn't get any more of the grassroots than this outfit does. In fact, I know that you have a couple of relatives working for you here.
Correct, my youngest brother, Dan.
And
oldest
brother Brian,
and Steve, and another crew member Ian. So right. We're all like E.
Yeah,
Stevie, Danny,
Danny,
Brian has E in it.
Right,
know.
I had to change my name.
And Lee Eon.
Yeah. We just can't spell.
Okay, well, good luck there, Ian, and you know you're gonna have a good time for the rest of the weekend, and just. Keep it clean and keep it fast and see if you can't get another one of those Richard Piper duels, you know, before the day's out.
We'll do our best. Thank you very much.
Okay. There you go. And lastly and finally, you forgive me if I give a really bad Scottish accent into the microphone there, man. Alistair McLean here with his the Mercedes he's running today. And we just did a tour around the G70 paddock. Sounds like the Predators are having a really good time so far and relieved that they may not have to race in the wet.
Yeah, some are. Some would like to play in the wet. Nice.
Like that one back there?
Yeah, there's a few fellows who like to run in the wet.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Are there any other cars that you're going to be driving this year besides this Mercedes?
We're hoping to get the Jag out on track as well, so we're going to keep working at it.
Mm-hmm.
And we've got a lot of work to do.
Yeah, absolutely. I remember last time I saw you here, you were in that 2002 BMW, the 1972 model. This is quite a step up in horsepower. No problem for you?
No, this is great. This is more like it. It's the BMW is a fantastic car, don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
But this is more tuned for this circuit.
Yeah, I would imagine so.
It's a good circuit for the Mercedes, so.
Yeah. So how are you dealing with the traffic? Well, you're pretty much used to it. You've been racing for a number of years now. What's your racing history like?
Checkered.
Checkered can be good and bad.
Yes, you might have seen our t-shirts. It started off in Britain.
Really?
Yeah, just doing timing sessions with the Alfa Romeo boys and then gradually over here back into it.
You don't want to drop any big British names that you might have gone fender to fender with?
No.
Okay. Well, then likely there weren't any.
That's probably right.
Okay. All right. Well, pleasure talking to you, Alistair, as always. And you keep it clean and keep it straight out there. And hopefully we'll have a lot more fun as the day progresses.